jobs, state officers, we congratulate you on your positions and wish you every success. Most of you were present for session one. For those joining us, a few facts. Today's Zoom sessions are being recorded and will be available on OSO's website and YouTube station by Friday, July the 31st. Further, a Zoom evaluation follows both sessions. Truly, those of you who were with us in the first session, we discovered our error. We now know what to do, so the evaluation should be at the completion of this session. We thank you for completing the short survey, which features a thumbs up and thumbs down. If you select the latter, there will be a drop-down menu requesting your opinion. Session two's question and answer period is slightly different from session one. There will be a short break halfway through the presentation. Questions will be answered following that break and then at the conclusion of that presentation. Zoom's chat feature allows you to ask questions which will be answered live. If your question is asked more than once, it will only be answered once. If further information is needed, please contact the OSO officer via email. The addresses are listed on the website. We found during our first session that everyone was helping in the chat. So as questions appeared, folks started putting in answers, but then we confirmed all of those at the end of the session. Today's training is only possible by the top leadership skills of your OSO officers, who accepted every challenge, willingly volunteered, and continue to perform all with style and grace. I want to emphasize that. We would not be here. We would not be having this without all of them. They are the reason we are here. And I thank them from the bottom of my heart for all of the contributions that they have made. In fact, they keenly represent President Kirkpatrick's vision of believe, belong, and build. We look forward to hearing your voices through Zoom's evaluation tool, helping us to believe, belong, and build. Wishing you every success on this exciting journey. Your first presentation is going to come from OSO's treasurer, Diana Haskell. We do know that after Diana is finished, that President Kirkpatrick needs to come back on to tie up a few of her loose ends from the first session. So I will turn this over to Diana Haskell. Thank you very much.
Lois, thank you for a lovely introduction to today's session this afternoon. And welcome and hello to many friends and new chapter leaders to session two. My name is Diana Haskell, and I serve as treasurer of the state organization. I'm from the Gamma Phi chapter in the greater Cincinnati area. I've been treasurer since Beth Archer's biennium, way back in 2002, and my goodness, much has changed in our organization since those days. My hope today in our time together is that I will be able to provide for you the resources and information necessary for the financial health of your chapter. I think as leaders, you understand that chapters need members to provide for the financial stability and the success of the chapter. And members expect our chapters to meet their needs. New members are attracted to your chapter by how successful your chapter responds to their needs. Our chapters are dependent upon the revenue driven by dues. So membership is extremely important. And we heard a lot about that this morning and some initiatives to create opportunities for more membership. I'm going to go to my screen share, and I hope somebody will give me a thumbs up that I've got it. Yeah, good. All right, here we go. Let's see if this is going to work. All right. I've provided a PowerPoint presentation. It is on the website as well if you want to go back through it. But a couple of tips. If you are new to Zoom or Zoom sometimes and sometimes don't, if you have a film strip of photos, pictures of those attending the session and would like to get rid of those, if you put your cursor on, I think, your picture and push the show small active speaker video, which is the second bar next to your name, you will only see the speaker. Now, Lois, I see you and I don't see anybody else. How'd that happen? Anybody know? Well, I don't know. So I don't see myself. So I don't know.
Neither did I when I presented and I was confused, but we see you.
Oh, well, that is what is most important.
That's right.
Thank you. And again, this is my very first presentation. So pardon me for errors. Pardon me for making any mistakes as we go through this. All right. Let's see if this is going to work. Everyone, fingers crossed. Maybe after being elected and after today's session, you may have this sort of feeling that there is so much to do and so little time to do it. Hopefully, after today and after this afternoon's session, you'll feel a little more confident and a little less stressed. What we hope for is that you'll find in today's session tools and resources to help you. This morning was no exception. You received many tools and many resources. This afternoon, hopefully, will continue on that as well. What are those resources? Well, the most important resource is this website. And if you don't have this as a favorite in your browser, I highly recommend that you do so. This is really the key to so many resources. And we're gonna start with that resource and a section on the website called Just for Treasurers. We are now at the Delta Kappa Gamma Ohio website. I hope you're familiar with it. And if you are, you'll notice.
It did not come up.
Now what?
Minimize your PowerPoint and see if it's behind it.
Okay. Let's see if I can do that. Okay, thank you. I will minimize the PowerPoint. Is it up now?
No.
Okay, let me do something else then, Eileen. I'll try one more thing and see if that'll work.
It might be in a slideshow.
I'm gonna try that. I'm gonna see if I can open it from the slideshow. What about now?
No.
All right.
Do you have your browser already open?
Yes, I do. So that is that. I don't know what to do now. But
does it appear under in your bar at the bottom?
I have Chrome opened, and that's what I'm using.
Go ahead, Don, and click on it.
I just did. And I came back to my PowerPoint. So, all right. So,
would you like me to bring it up on mine and then you can talk about it?
Would you mind, Eileen? I don't mind. Now, I stopped sharing, correct?
Yep.
I stopped sharing.
Just a minute. I have to bring up my browser first.
Okay, thank you. Apologies to everyone. Practice, practice, practice. Almost made perfect. Because I could see it. I assumed you could see it.
Yeah.
Diana, this is Lois. If you're having difficulty with that particular slide getting to the page you want, perhaps you could go on to the next slide and then we can all come back to it later.
I think we're right here. Eileen?
Okay. Yes.
Does everyone see yours? This, I see it, so I assume everyone can see it.
Sure.
So those in attendance, if you look on the screen where Eileen is pointing the cursor, you'll see a section below chapter presidents and information for them called Just for Treasurers. And Eileen, would you kindly click on Just for Treasurers? And on this page, ladies, there is every tool I think that you would need. They are listed in alphabetical order, beginning with the annual report of the chapter treasurer and continuing to a step-by-step dues and a member information. But what I'd ask Eileen to do next, and thank you, Eileen, so much for doing this, would you open the guidelines for chapter leaders? This is a very, very important reference tool. And Eileen, I don't thank you for scrolling. Continue to scroll. If there's one thing that you should read, and I don't think it'll put you to sleep, it's about 20 pages. Please take a look at the section. Eileen, can you scroll back up to the page previous? Beginning right here on page, right here, chapter finances. Eileen, it begins on page 19, and the topics include budgeting. And especially these points under budgeting are important for your chapter rules. What you want to make sure as chapter leaders, as you are looking at your rules, is do your rules allow for a budget process? And what is that budget process? And this document gives you some ideas on how to create that information in your rules so that your budget can move forward. It also goes on to dues and fees. And Eileen, we won't spend a lot of time on each of these, but a scroll through. Here is the information about the scholarship fee, that it is not something that is made up by the state of Ohio. It is an international requirement. The dues timeline, when do you collect? When are they due? When is the last date before a member is no longer a member for non-payment of dues, October the 1st? We've said many times there is no reinstatement fee, so a member can come back to the chapter anytime during the year. As you move through this, it's just information and tips and support, and it kind of takes the Constitution, the international standing rules, the go-to guide, and puts them together. Eileen, I'm going to ask you to hold right here. Puts those three documents together in a really easy to read and easy to reference document. Again, guidelines for chapter leaders. It's on the website. These are the responsibilities of the chapter treasurer. We do not have very many new chapter treasurers. For all of our benefits, and especially our chapter benefits, our treasurers remain. They become a very stable force for the chapters because they really do kind of become the glue of the chapters. But these are the responsibilities. If you are new to the position, these would be the things that you would especially want to pay attention to. And I would note in number two, the second bullet, we will spend some time today on these accounts and receipts and expenditures. And the reason this is so important is many organizations without good internal controls find themselves in situations where fraud can occur. We certainly do not want that to occur at the chapter level, nor at the state level, obviously, but internal controls manage that. Eileen, thank you for continuing to scroll down. If your treasurer changes, if you could hold it right there, if your treasurer changes and you have not notified international, the new treasurer does not have access to the dues portal. The only way another person gains access to the dues portal to post dues, to manage members, is by completing Form 87. Continuing treasurers do not need to do this. If you are a new treasurer and you do not have access to the dues portal, it is because your chapter has not completed a Form 87. So how do we begin the fiscal year? this kind of gets things started. We're going to also use the checklist, which I sent last night to all the treasurers. And again, Eileen, if you can continue to scroll through this for us, we appreciate that. Permanent files, if you could hold it right there. This is a burning question, and it's a question that really, I feel sometimes that I'm going to need to rent a either a pod for my driveway or a place to store all the records. But let's take a look at what things you really should be thinking about keeping and for how long. I do not think that anyone needs to keep bank statements forever. And there is a revision to this, which I will show you in the next slide. However, your IRS 990 should be kept permanently. Your membership records, again, do not need to be kept permanently unless that is in your chapter rules. Legally, they only need to be kept for 7 years. Your annual, your Form 15, I would suggest keep that permanently. It is a good record of the number of members year to year, et cetera, and it's a single piece of paper. So there are some things that you do need to keep permanently, and the other thing are minutes. Your chapter minutes must be kept permanently. We'll go into that again in the next slide once we get through this booklet. Eileen, bank accounts, and could you continue? Responsibilities, like I said, this is just going to be a good reference tool about filing the 990, about when do you need to do it, some ideas on how to raise revenue if dues do not seem to provide enough revenue for the activities of your chapter. Thank you, Eileen. Continue. More information about how your chapter makes contributions, whether they be to the international organization. There will not be information in this document, because it is an international organization, about chapter contributions to the Alpha Delta State Ohio Education Foundation, which is your local foundation, your Ohio. But this is an international document. Continue, thank you. More on contributions, et cetera. So about up through page 31, so we'll just kind of move through this, Eileen. Other membership procedures. We spent some time this morning talking about this, and we will continue this afternoon to talk about how important the treasurer is in maintaining accurate membership records. How do you order, you know, the next president's pin, other information about ordering. It's all right here. And about from page 19 to 31. Information about filing your IRS, required 990N. What is your employer identification number? Where is it? How do you find it, et cetera, in this part. So continue. And one thing I do want to spend just a second on right here, and this is red area that calls everyone's attention to something important. And this is that should your chapter fail to file an a 990N for 3 years, you are automatically revoked by the IRS, and you have to go back through the process of being recognized as a chapter and getting a new EIN number. Do not let this happen. I send out reminders. I think everyone understands how important it is to maintain your status with the IRS. We are a 501c6, and that's granted by the IRS, requiring us to file a 990N. Thank you, Eileen. We are just about at the end of this. Coordinating councils must also file an EIN. It must also file a 990 if they have an EIN number. I think we only have one that does. All right, there's a retention schedule, and it does differ a little bit from what they put in the earlier part of the document. But again, there are a lot of resources for us here. Eileen, thank you very much. And we'll just go to page 31, which is right here. And it kind of concludes the section on chapter finance. This goes into the financial review process, which we'll also talk about. Eileen, thank you so much. I'm wondering if we could just stay here, and then I'm going to ask you to help me do one more thing. All right, I'm just going to change it up a little bit, my presentation. The other resource that you have available is myself and all of the officers that are representing you at the state level. You can expect, as a treasurer, emails from me on a somewhat regular basis. And when I use the word regular, I do not mean monthly, and I do not even mean quarterly. I would have to say as needed. I will always try to alert chapter treasurers when there are due dates. I will send you forms with due dates. I will communicate with you about how things are going with that. If you would, treasurers, set up a folder that you can save my emails to so that you can refer back to them if you aren't sure about a deadline or a requirement or a form and you don't see it here, they will always be in my email. So setting up a folder with my emails can be helpful and can also be a resource. As the chat box is starting to fill up, I know that Lois is taking a look at that, and we will take a look at that in the next couple of minutes. Eileen, one of the things that I ask you to do now, since we're on the web page, is to go to the document that's called Finance Committee Guidelines Booklet. It's just about in the middle. And if for those of you who have are familiar with that, could you just stop just a moment? Thank you. Those of you that are familiar with this document knows that it will print as a booklet if you wish, or it can be printed as 8.5 by 11 sheets. This is an important booklet. And as Eileen scrolls through this booklet, my presentation is a little off, but I'm gonna go ahead since I've got Eileen working so well with me. Thank you, Eileen. Do we elect at the chapter level finance committee members? No, they are appointed. And treasurers, you are on the committee, but you are never the chairman of the finance committee. So keep that in mind, chapter presidents, as you are making those appointments. There's also a call for a financial review committee. In some chapters, the Financial Review Committee is also the Finance Committee. Again, your chapter rules will dictate if that is the case. If it is not the case, then you need a second committee that will review at the conclusion of the year the documents that the treasurer has produced all year long. This Financial Review Committee does not include the treasurer. She cannot monitor her own work. So this committee is not a committee that includes the treasurer. She prepares the materials, she gets ready for it, she presents those materials, but she may not participate. As you look down here, it describes the responsibilities of a finance committee, a very important committee. And these are based on international constitution and international standing rules. Thank you, Eileen, for moving into page 3. More about budgeting. And if you'll notice, the induction fee, about the third paragraph, of $10 is collected from every new member. $2.50 comes to the state of Ohio. $7.50 remain with your chapter. That is an international constitution item. It is not a rule that we are making up. Scholarship fees are also collected from all members. And those scholarship fees, if you would move, thank you, Eileen, we're just about there. Scholarships, let's take a look at this for a moment. Scholarships are those awards that a chapter gives to their members. The society and the state organization maintains a scholarship fund. A chapter may maintain a scholarship fund if it is agreed upon by majority vote. Those of you that have had long-standing scholarship committees know that there's probably in your history a vote that your members chose to do this. If you have not voted to do it, you may do it at any time. But remember, a scholarship is for a member. Conversely, many, many chapters are extremely generous with grants. And grants in aid are really funding for projects that your chapter wish to take on. Projects that your chapter wish to take on. It can also provide financial aid to non-members who are pursuing work in the area of education. The last sentence of grant in aid is something that I think many chapters are having trouble with. The funds from the $1 scholarship fee may not, actually shall not, and that's constitutional, shall not be used for service projects or to support students who are at the high school or college level who are preparing to be educators. What does all of that mean? That means that you have to keep those funds separate. We'll talk about that in a minute. Some chapters have assessments, others do not. Assessments may only be levied by a chapter. The state may not levy an assessment on any chapter. The chapter does that to itself based upon the needs of the chapter. Reserve members may not have an assessment fee. Moving on to a budget worksheet, which is in here. It's just a tool to get you started and get you thinking about that budget if you don't have a template at your chapter level. Thank you, Eileen, for scrolling through that. Notice the scholarship fees kept separate. The induction fee is kept separate. Some of you fundraise for your grants or for scholarships. Again, the only monies that have to be kept separate is this fee. Other funds that you raise can be used for grants, can be used for scholarships. And then an expense, of course, against income or revenue. And these are some ideas to get you thinking about that and as part of this booklet. And then finally, this is an important piece of this, and the reason that I think every chapter should print a copy of this. At some point this summer, every chapter should have an internal review. And again, that can be done by your finance committee without the treasurer participating, or can be done by a separate committee appointed by your chapter. Again, the treasurer only prepares the material, does not participate in this review. But the chairman of this review is looking for all of these items. And it is a good record for your chapter to have this along with the documents that are being reviewed. It allows for a check on every aspect of the work of the treasurer. And it's an important thing to do. And again, an important piece of internal controls. This is signed off on at the bottom by the chairman, and this should be kept as part of the permanent records of your chapter. Thank you. Another retention schedule. We just can't get enough of these. They're everywhere. But it also is included in this. All right, we are about 1:34, and I'm going to ask Eileen to allow me to take the screen back. And I think I just do that by clicking my share screen, correct? All right, yes, now yes. I'm going back to this and I'm gonna share that. Eileen, you without a doubt are phenomenal. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay, now this won't move. Okay, let me see what I'm doing wrong here. This is my recommendation for those of you who really do we really do need to retain and we really need to destroy appropriately documents. Again, this is taking all of the information that I can find, as well as legally, to kind of give you some tips on how long you need to keep certain documents. If you are making a treasurer's making a report at each chapter meeting, that is this item, your revenue and expenditure report. Keep those in your file for 7 years. Budget reports only need to remain for 4 years. I would say that membership records, a minimum of 4 years, there are recommendations that those should be kept forever. And I think I would check with your historian, and I would check with your chapter rules to see what the length of time that your chapter feels it's important to maintain membership records. Meeting minutes, as I mentioned, must be kept permanently. And in terms of your own chapter rules, they are usually in a state of revision at least every 2 years. And all you need to keep on those are the current copy. You do not need to retain former copies of your chapter rules. We went through most of this in the information that Eileen showed us, but this is on your checklist. For those of you who have the checklist in front of you, these are, as I said, items that we have already reviewed. We talked about the change of chapter treasurer, and again, the importance of that. The only person that has access is the person listed on Form 87, which is a change of treasurer or a change of treasurer's address. Many chapters have a new president, but a continuing treasurer. I strongly urge every chapter to contact their bank and make sure that the signature cards on your checking, savings, CDs, investments, etc., are updated. It is important that a second signature be available to your chapter should something happen to your chapter treasurer that she would not be able to fulfill her duties. The financial institution will inform you what documents you need, and if you need documents or help with that, I am happy to do so. Of course, we're in an age of online banking and online logins with the IRS. Please make sure that as chapter treasurer, you have, and your chapter president, you both have passwords and access to the checking accounts, savings accounts, and the IRS login. And they have to be kept secure, of course, because they are the financial records in the case of banking. But two people should have a path, should have the password and the username. I think for all of us, we should go to one more slide and take a break. In every chapter, your finance committee typically develops the budget. The treasurer really leads that discussion along with the president and other members of the executive committee as needed. That committee takes a look at the developed budget and amends it or approves it. And then, based on your chapter rules, it is likely that the finance committee will present that chapter operating budget to the membership for amendment and for approval. We've been at this now for about 40 minutes. How about if we take a 5-minute stretch break? Everybody check your phones. Everybody check your, get a drink of water. We'll take a 5-minute break, and I'm gonna put a little smooth jazz on in the background. So please take a moment and step away as I'm going to.
Hey Google, play smooth jazz.
All right, playing your Spotify playlist called Smooth Jazz on all speakers.
I I am. It turn it up a little bit.
Okay, thank you. Hey, Google, raise the volume. Thank you. Hey, Google, turn off the music. Welcome back. And thanks. I hope that you feel a little refreshed. I know I was able to get another bottle of water and I feel much better. And hopefully we will go forward. Eileen, is my screen on? Lois, is my screen on?
Yes, we have your picture and chapter finance.
Thank you very much. That's what I wanted to know.
Lovely picture.
Okay, we've been through this. We are now, I received one question regarding finance. Is that what you have, Lois?
I haven't received any.
Okay, one question from Kathy was the number suggested for the finance committee. How many members should be on the finance committee? And Kathy, and for those of you who have that been thinking about that, certainly the treasurer is one member of the finance committee, and if your chapter allows for it, three additional members. If not, I would suggest two. So a total of three to four, up to five if you have a large chapter and you have activities that they can help with. And I think there are many things that the finance committee can assist with, including collections of dues, as well as taking in money when you are having luncheons or collecting any monies. Your finance committees can sit at your right hand, treasurers, and help you be that second person, that second set of eyes on everything. So Lois, thank you for monitoring those questions. And as we see some additional ones, we will answer them as the session concludes, hopefully in about 20 to 30 minutes or so.
Glad to do it. If the message goes directly to you, I don't see it.
Oh, you don't? Okay.
If it goes to everyone, I can see it.
Okay. Thank you very much, Lois. Appreciate it. All right. Whoops. Okay. Sticky fingers here. I got to get my hands off of the computer. All right. Here we are back from break and the questions. And this is, I think, one of the most important areas for every treasurer and every president and every chapter to wrestle with. And that is developing what is in the vernacular of finance, internal controls. And internal controls simply means, do you as a chapter have a process for distributing money, and do you have a process for receiving money that is helpful and prevents the opportunity for any fraud? And I hate using that, but we have all read about the Little League baseball team that suddenly didn't have any money because the person who was in charge of the money took it. We don't expect that to ever happen in our chapters, but it doesn't happen because of internal controls. So what is it at the chapter level that you need to do as a chapter leader, president, executive board, to make sure that there is a clean and consistent, and I use the word consistent because that is, policies can be written, but the consistency of applying those policies make them meaningful and make them applicable and prevent anything from happening that shouldn't happen. What is the process that your chapter has for treasurers writing a check? Treasurers, I implore you, never, ever, ever pick up your checkbook and your pen, the chapter checkbook and then your pen, and write a check unless you have been authorized in writing to do so. Some of you are thinking, well, we did a budget, the money's there, we know. No. A budget is a forecast. It's ink on paper. This is a way in which you have formalized the process of check writing. It is exactly what that committee will need, the internal review committee will need, to verify that every check was appropriately written and correctly written for the amount that it was supposed to be written for. My question to you is, at the chapter level, do you have a process to request payments and or a voucher system that is used by every officer, every committee member, and every member who is requesting reimbursement or payment? That includes sending dues to the state. That includes sending dues to international. That includes everyone. Checks are checks are checks. Secondly, if that's true of disbursements, what about receipts? Is there a process at your chapter level, in your chapter rules, for accepting cash and checks? If you are accepting cash and checks, and they are at an event like a meeting or a luncheon or however your chapter organizes itself, and people are coming in and handing money over for either payment of a meal, lunch, a donation to Schools for Africa, a donation for a World Fellowship, whatever. When you receive money, are two people involved in that process? Again, this is an opportunity for your finance committee to step in and help. Let's take a look at some ways that you can do this. On the website that Eileen showed you earlier, just for treasurers, you'll find two opportunities. Your chapter may develop their own, but these are two that may be useful to your chapter. One is a template that can be run on a business envelope. In other words, a regular size, eight and a half wide envelope will accommodate this information. The nice part about using an envelope is that all the information is present on the outside of the envelope. The inside of the envelope can hold a receipt, an invoice, whatever it is, your order form for dues can hold all of those things, so that each envelope represents one check. This is simple. Your chapter name can go up here. Obviously, who do you make the check out to, chapter treasurer? When was the request made? Against what budget item? Everyone should understand that if they are requesting reimbursement, or they are, as a treasurer, if you are requesting a payment, you're making that against an item on your budget. If it is not on your budget, then your budget needs to be revised, and that means going back to the membership for a revision and a vote. The person who is making the request may not be the person who is being paid. Again, those just opportunities. The amount of the check, is there an invoice or a bill enclosed? And sometimes we get chapter members who make a purchase and say, I really don't want to be reimbursed for that. But the reason it's important for you to at least know about it is you are now able to do a better job of forecasting in the future. If someone has donated something to the chapter in the form of an item that they bought, or items that they've bought that they choose not to be reimbursed for, please ask them to put the receipts in the envelope and then check that they don't want to be reimbursed. There would be no check written, but at least you and the finance committee treasurers have a record of that. An explanation of the expenses, and this is critical. Every expense, and I don't mean most expenses, I mean every expense, must have the signature of your president or her designee. But that designee must be identified in your chapter rules. And then for the treasurer, you can fill out the bottom with the check number, the amount that you wrote the check for, the date of the check, and how you charged it. Maybe the sender or the person who made the purchase didn't understand what budget item it budget line it should have been paid against, but you know where you charged it when you made that record. This is on the right side, an alternative to that. It is a single 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper, which asks for the same information, and you'll notice president's signature and date are required. I spent most of the time as your state treasurer making sure that every chapter understood how important this is. And forgive me if you've heard my speech before, but it is the only way that we can ensure that all the funds, whenever you're handling other people's money, you must be more scrupulous than if you are handling your own. What about accepting money? How can that work? Well, as chapter treasurers, you know that oftentimes you receive monies that are, for example, your chapter dues. If you request your members send their chapter dues in one check, and then you divide it among international, state, scholarship, induction fees, et cetera, it would be helpful, wouldn't it, if you had a record of that. Even if you have 20 checks that you are depositing, breaking down those 20 checks provide for good record keeping for you. This is a deposit envelope. Again, it will print on exactly the same size envelope, the 8.5 by 11 business envelope, and it allows you to put your deposit receipt in here. So let's say your total deposit was $525, and you may or may not have cash. Where did it go? Did it go to checking or savings? And then how did that $525 get broken down? It is unlikely that you would have just one budget line item that all of those funds went to. It could happen, but unlikely. So here's an opportunity for you to record keep. If you are collecting money at a luncheon and you have a roster of all your chapter members, and next to that you have either they paid $20 in cash or wrote a $20 check for the luncheon, you can put that information along with the deposit that was made about those with those funds right in this envelope. It makes the internal review team very happy when they can easily find the date of a deposit, the amount of the deposit, how the deposit was split, as well as the date of a check, when the check was written, to whom the check was written, and for what purpose the check was written. A very important part of your responsibilities. Another important part, and this is a federal, we went over this a bit during Eileen's move through the guidelines for chapter treasurers and guidelines for chapter leaders, is this 990. And if you are not sure if your 990 was accepted, I can help you do that because the IRS provides for us a way to check whether or not your IRS filing was accepted and the date of that. So if you're not sure if you filed correctly and you would like to be sure, I'd be happy to help you with that. If you would please forward a receipt of the filing to the state treasurer, because I also must keep a record of your 990 filing forever. Again, the reason for my storage unit. Chapter dues. This has all changed tremendously in the last year. And this is a team effort. This is not just the job of the treasurer. This again can be a function of what your finance committee does. It can be a membership initiative. You can work as three or four committees together in an effort to collect dues. And I know that this spring, it was particularly difficult as you did not meet regularly and you did not have face-to-face communication with your members. But please note that all dues for the following year are due June the 30th. Our fiscal year begins July 1. That means you are expected to collect dues prior to the beginning of the fiscal year. That is why our July 15th first dues date is part of the gold key. We want to help you keep to those guidelines, and gold key is a way in which we can provide an artificial deadline, but it's certainly an important one. Of course, if you are a chapter treasurer, you know that we no longer use Form 18. We are using the dues portal, and you enter the dues portal through dkg.org. You go to the right side, My DKG, below that drop-down menu, My Account. And once you get into My Account, you are able then to manage an order, create an order, manage an order, manage membership, and change membership. You are the only one at the chapter level who has access to this particular portal. Other members, your president has access to membership information, but does not have access to the dues portion. Again, critical that if you are unable to access this, that you complete Form 87 and send a copy to me and to International. In addition to an order which you create with dues, there is also a need for you to complete a second form. This is also on the website, the Ohio website. I have sent this out repeatedly to treasurers and will be happy to do so. Each order, dues order, must also be accompanied by the OSO dues and fees payment report. The reason I need both of these forms, International only needs the order, is because I'm responsible for collecting the scholarship fee and initiate fee. You will recall that if you have a scholarship fee, you retain 80 cents, excuse me, if you have a scholarship committee, your chapter retains 80 cents of the $1 scholarship fee. You are required to send to me at the state for the state's scholarship use 20 cents. If you're per member, if your chapter does not have a scholarship fee, then you turn over the full dollar that you collected. And you do that each time for each member that you paid that has paid dues. If a new member joins your chapter, I must have a Form 81 along with her dues and her fees. In addition to the scholarship fee, remember she pays a $10 fee to the chapter. The chapter retains $7.50. We at the state level take $2.50 of that. It is again reported on the OSO dues and fees payment report. If you have members who have resigned from your chapter, they must do that in writing. They must present something in writing to the chapter president, and the chapter president must then present that information, or the treasurer or the membership committee chairman, someone presents that information to the full chapter membership. The chapter membership is expected to know which members have resigned from membership. Once a member has resigned from membership, whether that be because of health, because of other responsibilities, there are 8 reasons for not returning to membership. And each member who is not returning to membership, chapter treasurers, I must have a Form 18A that reports that they are terminating and the reason for their termination. If a member wishes to change status from active to reserve or collegiate to active, that also must be granted by a vote at your chapter level. The reserve member or the active member who wishes to move to reserve must inform the president, and reserve status is granted by majority vote of the chapter. It is not the member's choice. It must be voted on by the membership. It is likely that the membership will accept their reason for going to reserve status, but it is a formal process. Membership is a formal process. And so I just want to help chapter treasurers know that you have been charged with the responsibility of membership and maintaining membership records in your chapter. Again, I expect some questions on this. What are some tools that are available? And again, so that we didn't have to switch between the website and the slides, I put a small version. I hope it's visible, but if not, please know that on the Ohio website, DKG Ohio website, there is a dues chart, and this is current, and it explains the dues dates and the amount of dues for each membership type, honorary and inductee at the collegiate level, reserve and active. Once we hit January the 1st through March 31st, we really are in what is thought of as a reduced rate period. So if you induct a member in January or later, or if you reinstate a member in January or later, their dues are reduced by 50%. And that information is here. So this chart may be helpful to inform members or to assist the treasurer in understanding what is the due structure, when does it change, and what are the rates for each membership classification. On the right side is the form that was developed by Ohio to collect dues, fees, and for scholarship and induction. So again, with each dues payment that a treasurer makes, this should accompany it. So there should always be two pieces of paper, one check, two pieces of paper with each dues. So the scholarship fee is indicated here. So if your dues order is 10, your scholarship fee would either be $10 or $2, depending upon what is going on at your chapter level, whether there's a scholarship fee. The induction fee, if you are inducting a member and you put $2.50 here, I should expect to see in the envelope Form 81, which is a new member form. Her induction fee is here, and then below that is information that summarizes the calculations. So here is your order number 22597 of $213. Our scholarship fee, which I'm adding, our induction fee, which I'm adding, and this is my check. I'm writing one check for Ohio dues, Ohio scholarship fee, and Ohio induction fees. You don't need to write a separate check for scholarship fee or an induction fee. One check is sufficient. Makes it easier for all of us. But you split it, of course. I'll split it for you. Okay. Again, just to reiterate, chapter members dropped. Form membership should be recorded in the minutes of the meeting in which they were terminated. So if a member chooses not to renew membership for reasons of health, and you know that early, you may present that at your first meeting, and that may be accepted and in the minutes. If later, and the member is dropped because of non-payment of dues, after October 1, international drops members that have not paid dues, then chapter treasurers, you need to present those members who have not paid dues so they can be recorded also in your meeting minutes. This morning, there was quite a bit of emphasis by Kathy Tenney on updating and correcting information about members. Every member has access to her membership information. Again, log in to deltakappagamma.org and go to log in with your member number and the password. And if you don't know the password or have never changed it, it's DKG2014 Society. That is the password unless you have changed it. Every member has access to the website by putting in her member number and that password. She can update her own information. The treasurer does not have to do that. If the member does it, it automatically goes to the portal for the treasurer. Here's where it doesn't go. It never makes it to the voice editor. So in order for the voice editor to have accurate email information, it does have to be transmitted at the chapter level. So if the editor is to send out the voice to as many members as possible, those email updates must be sent to her as well. So I ask you, and I ask if the treasurers ever have extra time on their hands, that they may go in and make those changes. They certainly have the ability to do it and can do it, but each member can also do it. Whoops, I don't want to change that. We talked about the consistent method for recording revenue and expenses, about keeping fund accounts separate, scholarship money recorded separately from dues. It's used for a different purpose. And chapters with a very large scholarship fund may want to consider a separate account for those funds, whether they be a savings account or another checking account. Chapter treasurers, you are expected to provide a written as well as an oral statement of financial activity, revenue against expenses, against the budget for each meeting. That keeps your membership informed. It's a document that is then recorded with the minutes and a document that goes with the meeting minutes. Of course, you know from Joyce's presentation this morning that we do not vote on this statement. Instead, we accept it to be filed. If the chapter leadership team, executive board requests a statement of financial position, that would be what are the assets of the checking, savings, investment accounts, against liabilities, treasurers, you are expected to present that upon request. Each month, bank statements must be reconciled. That would be deposits as well as checks. And that reconciliation should be filed and be ready to present to your internal review committee at the end of the year. It's recommended that the internal review committee complete their work by the end of July or sometime in early August so that the treasurer can be informed if there are any discrepancies or any needs for correction. She can be informed so that she doesn't have too much time in the year before those corrections are made. Her book starts July the 1st. I'd already mentioned that members, and I believe this was a question this morning, how do we get our ID number? Members have access to that and can print their own membership card. They can also add a photo by going to dkg.org, my DKG to my account, and she can update her personal information and add a photo and print a membership card. Perhaps your members don't know this. And this is something that either as chapter treasurer or as president or as a membership chairman, you may want to bring up and make this information available. The section in the guidelines for chapter leaders talked about contributions. And our chapters are incredibly generous. I will have a report ready for your review in the voice in September, which shows just exactly how generous our chapters are. Our chapters are generous in a variety of ways. They support locally their own initiatives and scholarships. They also are generous with the Alpha Delta State Ohio Educational Foundation, and they are generous with the International Society. These are usually budgeted items, so treasurers, if you have a budget item and no one is bringing that contribution forward, you may need to ask the Finance Committee to initiate a request to distribute those funds. Oftentimes at the end of the year, I get frantic notes, oh, I forgot to make our contribution. This is an opportunity for your Finance Committee to assist you. It's not just your responsibility. You certainly write the check, but you are not responsible for remembering to write the check. The dues portal and the membership changes are of course made by signing in this way, and here is the password for every member unless that member has changed it. It is DKG 2014 Society. Eileen said this loud and clear, and I also reiterate it. Chapter treasurers, chapter presidents, kindly begin the subject of an email request information distribution to me, Eileen, any officer, by beginning with your chapter name. Alpha Alpha, Form 6. Alpha Gamma, Form 15. It is so helpful because then I'm not guessing who is sending it to me. I know exactly who is sending it to me, and it is so much easier for me to file, keep track of it, if you have put the subject, your chapter name, in the subject line. We appreciate all that you do. You are an incredible, incredible group of women, and my hat's off to all of you. My final slide is for chapter treasurers. Final tool in your toolbox. Navigating the dues portal. What do you do when you are paying dues? How do you add a member? How do you transfer a member? How do you reinstate a member? How do you manage a member who is changing from active to reserve, etc.? I created what I call my cheat sheet. It's called Step by Step. I've sent this out to our treasurers. It is on the website under Step by Step. And if you follow each column down, you will be able to successfully pay dues, add a member, transfer a member, reinstate a member, and manage any member information if you wish. The one area that continues to be problematic for you and for international are those members who are deceased. International will take a member off of your roll if the chapter president or her designee submits a Form 6 to International. Form 6 reports the death of a member. It is the official way in which that member is removed from your membership roster. You'll notice, many of you, if you have looked at your chapter roster, that there are members listed there who have been deceased for 10 years or longer. And that is because the Form 6 process was not in place. So when they uploaded all of the information about your membership, all of those members got uploaded. So as a chapter, if you wish to take this on and clean up your database, clean up your member portal, and go through it and wish to identify members who you know are deceased, you can easily send an email to International, to the membership team at International, list those members who you know are deceased, and they will remove them. Going forward, one more time, Form 6 to International, to Debbie Cantor, who is your membership chairman at the state, and to myself, ensures that that member is removed from your roster and ensures that she is recognized in the voice and honored, and the membership committee also has an opportunity to continue that sadness by sending a note to the families. So in closing, again, my hat's off to every single one of you. I know that there are some items that Diana Kirkpatrick, President Kirkpatrick, wishes to speak about as I close this up. I will be reviewing your chat items and I will come back on and answer questions after President Kirkpatrick and Lois make their final remarks. But again, thank you. Please count on me to be in your corner. I'm your biggest cheerleader. I'll help you. I'll help your chapter any way I can. Thank you.
Thank you, Diana Haskell. Now, when you get to your chat room, I try to sort of organize things to make it easier for you. So there were several messages at the beginning where people were having some difficulty logging in, and those were more of an attendance issue. But I've addressed those. And another message just...
Stop sharing your screen so that they can...
Excuse me?
I'm sorry?
Your screen.
I should stop sharing?
Yes.
I'm sorry. Thank you very much for that. I'm sorry, Eileen.
Oh,
sorry.
Well, you see all the Zoom chat right there. I've tried to just organize it in a better fashion for you. Would you like me to ask you those, or do you feel comfortable going ahead and reading them and then replying?
I'll tell you what, if you don't mind, Lois, I would love for you to ask the question, ask it and answer it. We'll try it that way.
Hey, there we go. Okay. And so we'll do that now, or do you need a little break since you've been talking?
I'm having a drink of water. I'll tell you what, why don't we do that unless President Kirkpatrick wishes to speak?
No, you go right ahead. It's fine.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, super. Well, there at the beginning, and thanks so much for folks that we could see your names, but we couldn't see you. But I know that you were concerned about getting credit for being here. And so I think we've addressed all of those. And I've sent that out to everybody, so everyone should have that. Okay, coming on down. Okay, here's a question from Susan. And I wanted to clarify her question, and then others have responded to it. But Susan's question is to clarify, is it possible for the state treasurer to also alert the chapter presidents as to the number of members in the chapter?
Is it, let me just hear the question one more time, because can I also communicate with the chapter president regarding?
The current roster of members. They would
The chapter treasurer has access to that.
I believe where the issue comes in case they were not maybe present at the same time. But from what I'm hearing from you and what I'm reading in other responses, that it would be most helpful for the chapter president and the chapter treasurer to work out a system so that the treasurer can share those names in the roster and they are on the same page.
I think that's true. And the chapter treasurer can download and print a roster that's available to her in her dues portal. And I, because I'm not a chapter president, I don't know what the chapter president has access to, but I do know they have access to membership information. How much membership information they have access to, I do not know, as I don't have access to it myself. I have access to every chapter, so I can go in and help a chapter with any roster question or any support. I have access to every chapter, but I do not have access to information that would be available if you are a chapter editor, if you're a chapter president. Each position has access to certain information.
I think to answer your question, I think they were just trying to get the set number of members that they have in their chapter, did not want to know the positions, that we have 35 people, we have 12 people, and who they are. And there were some other suggestions from other people who've stated that suggest the chapter treasurer print out a list for the president, maybe do that monthly, that they could balance that. or put something in their chapter rules about how they go about doing that, their standing rules. So I'm hopeful for Susan that we have answered your question correctly. If not, put another chat in there and we'll get that when it comes up.
Great question.
Okay, another question here is from Nora Lee. Do you recommend using PayPal for dues payments and other payments?
You certainly have access to PayPal. And I think any chapter that is large and wishes to have alternative payment forms should look into it. Be aware that PayPal charges a fee and you will lose part of the dues unless you build a fee into your dues to cover the PayPal fee. But it certainly has made a tremendous difference at the state level when we use PayPal for convention registration. It makes convention registration very easy and very seamless. So it certainly is, Norley, an option that your chapter could explore. Other payment options besides check and cash is what PayPal offers. And in an environment such as we're in, it may not be a bad idea for chapters to look into that, particularly large chapters.
Wonderful, thank you. And Norley, and the same with everyone, if we've not captured it, or if I've not captured your intent, please let us know. This is two questions that we've combined into one. What is the recommended procedure for reimbursing a president or a treasurer?
Love that question. Now you need a backup person. I could recommend that the chairman of the finance committee be your backup person. Ask her to verify those expenses, and she can, as long as everyone understands that she has the opportunity to do that in place of the treasurer, in place of the president, as need be. But I think that's a wonderful job for the committee, the finance committee chairman.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much here. This is a question from Barb, who's asking us about Gold Key, and perhaps they may have two members who paid their dues after July the 15th. They're wondering if they could still be eligible for a part of Gold Key.
I am so glad that came up. And and what I'd like to mention here is that every chapter that submitted dues, regardless if it were dues for two people or 87 people, if your chapter submitted dues by the 15th of July, you received the Gold Key point, regardless of how many. We know that there will continue through the summer and through the fall to have additional dues come in, and we understand that and we honor it.
That is great.
Did not affect Gold Key.
Wonderful, thank you. Up from Eileen, does a chapter actually have to collect the scholarship money to only pay that portion of the dues fee, or can we have a scholarship fund alone? Would you like me to repeat that?
Okay, I think I understand what the question is.
Good.
The Constitution and the standing rules both require that $1 per member be collected for the scholarship fee. It does not matter if you have a scholarship fee in your chapter or not. Every member pays that fee. It is the responsibility of the chapter to either retain 80% of it if they have a scholarship fee and pay 20% to the state if they do, or they turn over 100%. They don't have a choice about that amount. In other words, it's not, I collect it, but we have a scholarship, so I'm keeping it all. You can keep 80%, but you must turn over 20%.
So,
I hope that answers the question.
Oh, I think that it did, and if not, we'll find out in another chat there. So thank you. We had a question about the password. They had requested, please repeat the password, but then you did. And so it was, I've got the password, thank you. Okay, this is from Susan. Since International Drops members who do not pay dues, do we still need to file Form 18A at that time and send it to International and you?
No.
Oh, no. That is wonderfully surprising because...
That was easy. No, you don't have to do that again. They have been dropped for non-payment. Form 18A is identifies a member who has stepped away from the chapter for a variety of reasons. There are seven reasons: moving out of the area, health, other responsibilities, etc. But non-payment of dues, you simply are dropped. You can be reinstated at any time, but we don't have to fill out another 18A to reinstate those members that we've lost for non-payment of dues.
Thank you. Also from Susan. I'm not sure where. Another one from Susan. Is there a way to check to see if our members' email addresses are correct with the void?
There are people that are not muted and they're interfering with you with that feedback. Please, if you are on and not a speaker, mute yourself.
Thank you, Eileen. Diane, do you need me to say that again?
Please.
Sure.
Thank you.
Is there a way to check to see if our members' email addresses are correct with the voice?
Well, that's a good question. And that's really a conversation between your chapter and Kathy Tenney. I would suggest that you may poll your members and say, are you receiving the voice? And if not, send me your email address and I'll make sure that it gets to Kathy Tenney. There's no other way of doing it. It's a manual process. It's a slow process, but that's the only way that I know that we would ever be able to verify. Kathy does upload, I think, regularly the updated emails and makes those changes, but I don't know how regularly she does that or how often she does that.
And if Kathy is still here, I might bounce the ball over to Kathy and ask her if she would like to add anything else to that. Okay, well, we'll check back with Kathy later in case she stepped
in. These are all great questions. These are questions on everybody's mind. I'm glad someone's asking them.
Next question, do members need their Delta Kappa Gamma number, their account number, to log into their own account?
Yes, they do. They must have their ID number. If they don't have it, ask your chapter treasurer for it and she'll be happy to give it to you. But that is your username, mm-hmm. is your account number, ID number, excuse me.
You mentioned before it's on their card or you can get it.
If you have been a member for a number of years and have a card, it's on there. Mm-hmm. But if you're a new member, you don't have a card. You don't have access to your ID number. Your treasurer does. The minute she enters you as a new member, she gets an ID number. So it's the responsibility of the treasurer to inform the new member or to inform any member of their ID number upon request.
Thank you. Susan had just a note that she added to the earlier one about the Form 18A. And she said, of course, International will remove the members who have dropped too. She's just added that to clarify. From Barb, Diana is a fabulous help. Thank you very much. From
Susan. Thank you.
Thanks, Diana. Another question, do presidents also have access to member ID numbers?
I do not know the answer.
Okay. Diane, can I interject for a second? This is Ann Todd.
Yes.
It seems like when I was chapter president, when I logged into my account on the DKG website, that they did enable me as chapter president to access the membership roster. Once I was no longer president, I didn't have access. I don't know if that's still the case. But that might be something that someone may want to try. I can't remember how I got to it, but I know that that could be an option. So you don't have to rely on your treasurer.
And thank you so much, because not being a president, I don't know. But when the treasurer logs in and when the president logs in to the DKG website, you want to go to My DKG, My Account, and then in your account, there'll be a red bar. I'm sorry, that's my phone. A red bar that will say Chapter Connect. If you click on Chapter Connect, you will definitely get something. But I don't know how much the chapter president gets.
And that sounds right, Chapter Connect. But I'm sure once they get there, they'll be able to get, they'll be able to figure it out.
Thank you, and Diana. Let's see, Nora Lee said thank you. Debbie says thank you. You've been a great help. Irene, how do you download the membership information to an Excel file to make a current roster?
Well, that is tricky because it depends on how large your chapter is. I could work with someone on that. I have downloaded the entire roster of the 3,600 names. And it has gone to an Excel very easily, but I don't know exactly any tips or tricks on that, because from the download, it does go to an Excel file. And then you can save it in your computer as an Excel file, a roster. But I'm not sure that I could be of assistance to her in this large group, but if she'd like to contact me, we can work through it.
Thank you, and Irene, you have an invitation there. From past state president, Donna Myers, she states, the president may request a roster list of members. The roster automatically comes to the treasurer, and the request must be requested from international.
Can I speak to that? That is not accurate any longer.
Oh, they have changed that?
Because now we are all in a dues portal. The president does have access through Chapter Connect. The editor has access through Chapter Connect. The treasurer has access through Chapter Connect. They're bypassing that international request because it's available to you.
Thank you.
Very important that the treasurer and the president be on the international list. And I believe in order for you to be there, you have to complete a form that President Kirkpatrick also receives. In other words, just like Form 6 removes a member, form, I think it's 110, which is a roster of chapter officers, has to be submitted to international in order for them to grant access to the president and to others in your chapter who may need that State Connect access. So there's a formal process, and I believe it's with a form.
Thank you. From Nora Lee, Diana, thank you for the response on PayPal. Is there someone who can guide chapters who choose to use PayPal?
I didn't get the second part of the question. Is there?
Basically, is there someone within OSO who could help chapters set up PayPal?
Well, Eileen has been wonderfully helpful to the state organization. I do not know. I can't speak for Eileen. And right now, I don't believe there is anyone, but we could certainly look into it at the state level if there's interest. But Eileen McNally has set up the PayPal accounts for the state. I can't speak for her if she'd be willing to help a chapter set that up. But perhaps we could learn as state officers so that we could help chapters. We haven't tried it yet, but we may be able to do that.
For positive thinking, when we have in-person convention, maybe that could be a breakout session or two. Not with Eileen, but unless that's something she wishes to do. But I know others have in there personally or professionally have PayPal. So that might be a possible topic.
That's exactly right. Good suggestion.
Okay. From past president, Donna Myers, just wanted folks to know that if you are making a donation to ADSOEF through PayPal, they will be reduced by a fee. Anything with PayPal has a fee, which I think, Diana, you've alluded to as well.
Yes. Thank you, Donna.
That fee is around 3%.
Okay. Thank you. From Stephanie, Diana, you said two papers that are submitted with the dues checks. One is for the OSO dues and fees report. What is the other paper?
It's the actual order that she would print from the dues portal. So every treasurer, when they submit dues, prints a minimum of three or four copies of their dues order. One copy of the order goes to International with the check for International dues. One copy comes to the state as well as the OSO dues. One copy should be held by the treasurer for her records.
Okay, thank you. And this is from Ann Todd, but I think Ann already said this, but I'm just going to reemphasize it. When she says at one point chapter presidents had access to membership information for the chapter through the dkg.org website, is this still the case?
Again, I'm not a chapter president, so I don't know. But I know they have access to some information on membership. And I believe it is all the information, including chapter ID, status, phone number, email address, if it has been recorded, mailing address, and date of initiation. I believe they have all of that information available to them for every member, and it's in the manage members section.
Quite a bit of information available. Thank you.
It is.
And from Sally, when will we receive a receipt from International for dues?
Sally,
I'm sorry, I've said that wrong. Will we receive a receipt from International for dues?
Sally, that is a question that I do not believe I can answer, except to tell you that your receipt is your billed order. And you can check to find out. You have a billed order column and a paid order column. Once your status as your chapter dues moves from billed to paid, they have cashed your check. So I would print out the order form and hang on to it as a copy from International. It can go in that voucher envelope that you're keeping or attached to that voucher that your president has signed to authorize you to write that check to International. But you know when International has cashed your check, when they have moved your order from billed to paid. And you can check that anytime on the dues portal for your chapter.
Thank you. And from Teresa, I'm a new president. And as a new president, I do not have access to our chapter membership through the website. Is it Chapter Connect? Is this because I'm new?
I think it's because they don't know you're a new chapter president.
Okay.
So I'm going to defer to President Kirkpatrick, because I think there is a form that is completed and sent to International that lists all the members who are on the new executive team of your chapter. So it will list your president and every officer that you have at your chapter level. And I believe President Kirkpatrick gets a copy of that form, as does International. And International will only change that information from their previous president to the current president when they receive that form. And I don't know if there's a problem, then we need to contact International and I'm happy to help you. I have been working with any problems that have occurred through email and I just forward your email with my response onto International, and they respond to both of us. So if you don't have access, you've completed that form, let's figure out how to get your access opened. And I think all we need to do is contact International. But I need an email to help you do that. I need you to contact me with that information, and we can move forward.
Okay, thank you. Next is, we're getting close to the end here, and it is from Susan. When treasurers pay dues and print a receipt, all this information is on this page. The member's account number, name, active or reserve, and the treasurer can just give a copy of that to the president. So I think Susan was just backing up what has previously been said. So
wonderful, thank you. I love problem solvers. That's great.
Vicki says, excellent job, thank you.
Thank you, Vicki.
Teresa says, I've already sent in my form. And Catherine says, some of us have not officially installed due to the virus. So
an installation is not required to be the president. I mean, your chapter has voted you in, even if they have not installed you, they voted you in. So I think that we should assume that you are the president, treasurer, other responsibilities in your chapter, other roles in your chapter that other officers have. So even though you haven't been installed, it does not mean you do not have access to the information you need.
Catherine says, thank you. And Anne said, I just submitted a chat to International. Yes, presidents will have access once they receive Form 110. Sorry, access to the membership rosters.
That is correct. 110 is the secret.
Anne's been busy typing there. I've been watching her. So thank you.
If I may say a word here, they're at International, they are not in the office only but intermittently. So things are slow. And so, yes, Teresa, we did get your Form 110, probably one of the first ones that I received. And I think probably as soon as they get it processed, hopefully sooner rather than later, you'll get that access, and they'll probably send you an email accordingly.
Thank you. Everything's running a bit slower these days, isn't it? I think Joyce has a question.
Yes, I've been trying to get on chat, but unsuccessful so far. I've been criticized for this due to security reasons, but what our chapter does in the handbook, where we list each member and their address and all that, we include their membership number. So the members can find their number very easily right there in the handbook. Now, the fact that that's now open to anybody who looks at our handbook, some people feel that could be a security problem, but we have not had any problems with that, and it's solved our membership number problem. So members can find it right away. Thank you.
Thank you. I believe I've gotten all your questions. Is there anybody who wants to add something else?
Eileen McNally here.
Okay,
we are going to be reviewing our chapter rules, and I wondered if Diana Haskell she kept saying, now, if this is in your chapter rules, or if this is in your chapter rules, most of that have not been in our chapter rules. Is there a guideline, an example, that's what I want, an example of these things that should be in our chapter rules that we can address the finances when we revise the chapter rules?
I am not in, I don't do compliance in your chapter rules, but I think that Joyce Jones-Weinkamp and her team are working on templates for chapter rules. And I'm happy to work with them to help with the finance questions that may arise. Where should they be? How should they be stated? Opportunities to make sure that you have included in your rules a process, because that's what rules are. They're the process by which we do things so that we don't have to make it up every time we have to do it. So I'd be happy to work with the governance team, the bylaws team, and the chapter rules team to create that template. But I believe Joyce and her team, they are working on that. That's my understanding. But be happy to help them with that.
Well, on behalf of Joyce and her team here, we have not gotten that far yet. We are in the process. We have changed the policies and procedures, updated it to meet the new changes from the international, and we are now converting that into standing rules so that we can match up exactly with international. We haven't gotten to the templates yet, but that's on our list.
Wonderful. Well, thank you, Diana. Thank you so very much for everything and for everyone giving questions and responding to questions. We all learn from each other. I'm going to bounce the ball over to Diana Kirkpatrick, our president. And did you have some items that you would like to include?
I just have one thing that we were wanting to talk about, and it's called staying connected. I had a conversation with a pretty active member of OSO, and she made a comment, "I feel so disconnected." And it hit me. Well, if she feels disconnected, and she is very social and is involved and goes out and does things, what about our members and chapters that aren't? What is it that we need to do as an organization, especially during this time when we're all socially distancing, not able to meet in groups more than 10, although we have, and we see the results of that with a resurgence of the virus. So it got me to thinking, and I called together a team of what I call those who think outside the box. They came up with quite a few different activities to keep not only the chapters, and I'm hoping the chapters are working on this, and I know they are. We have to, and that's part of the membership goal key, is connectivity. What is it that you are going to do as a chapter to keep your members connected with each other? Since you can't meet, or you're going, you know, hopefully you'll be doing some Zoom, but then that's limited for those chapters that have limited internet access. So I would say they're almost up a creek without a paddle on that one, but they have to come up with creative. And even if it's just calling a phone chain or whatever, but this committee, we met for a campfire side chat. We had love. Everybody brought their marshmallows and whatever. We met for an hour and they came up with some ideas. Now we at the state level are going to start the ball rolling. We're a professional organization, but I think we will have lots of professional activities too. But I think we need to sprinkle in between that some fun so that we can have some humor these days. Our first activity is going to be August the 6th, I believe, with a bingo game. It's bingo OSO style. You'll read more about it in The Voice, and you will get a constant contact blast. And I took a snapshot of everybody that had their hand raised, so I know you promised to follow through and read all the articles in The Voice and read the emails that you're going to get and the constant contact blast. Just know that it's coming, and I'm going to charge the chapters with activities of your own. Come up with some creative things. And by the way, we're going to be doing roundtables. We're going to be book discussions, book club, a state book club, reading books, writing poems, crafting. I know we've got a couple crafters here. And if you know of anybody in your particular chapter that's really good at leading group discussions, they have a particular talent that you think they would be willing to share with those of us at the state level, just to get our chapters involved, to keep us connected. Like I said, I miss seeing people face to face, and I get a little antsy when I can't see someone face to face. So I don't know about the rest of you, but I just need for us to stay connected, to work really hard and vigilant at getting and keeping us. And the reason I say that is because we have four chapters that have dissolved. We will be voting four chapters in August. And I know it's not really through any fault of, I mean, it's been coming a long time, but I think the impetus was the virus that just finally was the straw that broke the camel's back. So to prevent further chapters who are struggling, we've got to work really hard to stay connected. We're a good organization. We're an organization that has a worthy composition of earnest and committed women, educators who are forever hopeful, who are forever helpful, and who are forever united in the purposes of the Delta Kappa Gamma Society. So I want to thank all of you for being here today. We are truly blessed to have you by our sides. We are and will be forever grateful for your commitment to our Ohio organization. I want you to continue to be safe and strong. We truly are in this together. Thank you, guys. Can't wait till we meet again. And I'm going to hand it over to Lois, and she's going to tell you what we do next.
Well, before you leave, we actually need you to do the thumbs up and the thumbs down. If you do a thumbs down, tell us what we need to do better. And we have learned how to do this better now. So we'll let you leave the meeting, and then we will be, actually Diana will be the last person to leave, and that will submit us and make sure things are good.
Would like the officers to stay. Don't leave.
Okay. Thank you again. And I'm sending you a chat, everybody a chat right now. So thank you again. Again, so very grateful for being with you today. Thank you.
And Lois, you're a dream. Thank you so much for getting this all together. Couldn't have done it without you.
Well,
thank you so much.
I had a little part. Everybody else just carries on.
She says a little part. It's a big part. So she kept us going, and we really like part four. This was our fourth planning session. Okay, should we do a group hug? Group
Yay.
Hug? Thank you, guys.
Thank you. See you now.
You need me too, Diana? I mean,
yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yes.
It's interesting watching everybody just disappear.
They're all just trying to figure it out.
And thank you for watching my husband walk back and forth several times. I was supposed to be on the iPad in the kitchen, but that wasn't working so well. So we had it all organized, but he kept trying to tiptoe around, but he's here. So thank you.
Those that can't do it, just raise your thumb. The rest of you can unmute now.
Okay, good.
There we go.
Hello. Okay, I'm going to warn you. I have grandchildren in the car. I'm back on the road. On the road again.
Can you remember that you have grandchildren in your car?
Yeah.
All right.
Here, say hi, Lizzie.
Hi.
Hi, Lizzie.
Hi, Lizzie.
Oh my gosh.
I'm gonna shut my video down so I don't make you sick, but I'll keep my audio on. Okay.
Okay. Just be safe, please.
I am. I'm about an hour away. We're doing well.
Good.
We still have two that
yeah. We're down to one. Margaret,
Roberta, and Margaret.
She can't even show us her thumb, her real thumb, and. Oh, and Roberta. Roberta, too.
Mm-hmm.
Yesterday I sent you all something. So look for a little something in your mail by the end of the week.
Oh, you are too good.
It wasn't a jigsaw puzzle, but.
Yeah. And did you see the last, from Chris?
Snotty, yes.
Yeah, fine. Yeah. Puzzle pieces fit together.
Yeah. She is my chapter president.
Oh, okay. Yes, chapter. That's right. I forgot about that. Yeah.
We'll go to meetings together.
Yeah. Somebody said just thumbs up. They couldn't get it to work and they just did thumbs up. That's great.
I should say new grandmother, Chris Snotty. Yes.
Oh. As of when?
I think it was... was within the year. I've lost track of.
Oh, okay. It wasn't yesterday or the day before.
No. It was some months ago. But she's all happy. The baby is on the West Coast, though.
Oh, that's awful. Well, ladies, I just want to thank you so much for all the efforts you put into this. I think it went well. We had all. I didn't see one thumb down, but I wasn't looking for it either, so.
Well, I wanted to ask Eileen, does that show up in a report somewhere?
It should be. When Diana logs into her account on the website, it should be.
I'm hoping. We'll figure it. I'll have to go look.
There's no rush.
I have the recording. I will send them to you, Eileen, with the... the graphics for session one and for session two. Can we just use that as the icon to click on?
Yes. By the way, you're recording. Do you still want to record?
Oh, probably not.